The message that he left for me meant everything to me. I clung to it. I listened to it repeatedly in the days after.
Everybody has told me that has lost loved ones, you'll lose the sound of their voice. I've probably listened to the message hundreds of times.
It's available anytime I want to play it back. It's there. I hear it and I know it. I'm still very fragile to listen to it, and so I'm comforted to know it's there, but I don't listen to it.
On September the 11th, 2001, nearly 3,000 families lost a loved one. The Twin Towers collapsed with such destructive force that only 300 bodies were recovered. But for some families, there is another legacy. Trapped inside the towers, many people tried to make desperate contact with the outside world. Some were able to speak on the phone. Others could only leave messages. Since that day, families have lived with the memory of these final words from their loved ones. Many of these calls have never been heard in public and are featured here for the first time. All are used with the full consent of the relatives, who only now feel ready to talk about them. These recordings shed light on what really happened inside the towers, but they also reveal something more profound about the choices people make in their final moments, who to turn to, and what to say.
Obviously a pretty scary experience. I saw a guy fall out of probably the 91st story all the way down.
Okay. Now you can stay on the line with me.
I just wanted to let you know I love you and I'm stuck in this building in New York. There's lots of smoke, and he just wanted you to know that I love you always.
My dog, Coco, wakes me up somewhere approximately 5:30 in the morning and wants to go for a walk. So at 5:30 in the morning, I get out of bed, brush my teeth, throw some water on my face. We walk through the woods for half an hour, 40 minutes. I say a little prayer every single day and talk to Melissa. So it's just, I know she's there. I know she's listening to me. I was the last person from the outside world that she spoke to. I'll always remember that. When you fall asleep sometimes at night and you close your eyes, you can just see her face there saying, "Dad, I love you."
On September the 11th, Bob Harrington's daughter Melissa was in New York for just one day. Aged 31, she was a high-powered business executive and was there to oversee the merger of her company. The meeting was on the 101st floor of the North Tower of the World Trade Center.
She was only going to be there that Tuesday when the merger was done. She was flying back to California the next day.
We found nothing of Jim. He was completely destroyed. So the fact that I'd spoken to him means so much to me. I think that the healing process is ongoing. It's important to let people know what families of 9/11 have been experiencing, what we've been going through, what we've gone through. We still have those memories that we don't want anybody to ever forget.
Jill Gartenberg had just started a family with her 35-year-old husband, Jim. A successful real estate executive, Jim had recently accepted a promotion at a new company. On September the 11th, he had only gone in to clear his desk at his office on the 86th floor of the North Tower.
Saying goodbye, I love you, is the last thing I can remember seeing him walking out the door that morning on September 11th.
We just had a plane crash into level 4 of the World Trade Center. The World Trade Center, tower number 1, is on fire. The whole outside of the building was just saying every available ambulance to World Trade Center now.
In the minutes after American Airlines Flight 11 collided with the North Tower, the live pictures were flashed across the world.
We have numerous people trapped.
But those inside were unable to see what had happened. Desperate for information, they made more than 3,000 calls in the first 10 minutes alone.
He says he's at the 105th floor at One World Trade Center.
At the top of the North Tower, 100 people were attending a conference at the Windows on the World restaurant. Among them was 31-year-old Christopher Hanley, who made one of the first recorded calls to 911 emergency services that day.
Yeah, hi. I'm on the 106th floor of the World Trade Center. We just had an explosion.
The 106th floor?
Yes.
106, okay.
We have smoke and it's pretty bad. We can't get down the stairs.
All right.
We have about 100 people up here.
Do not leave, okay? There's a fire or an explosion or something in the building. All right, I want you to stay where you are.
Yes.
All right, we're there. We're coming up to get you.
See the smoke coming up from outside the windows down.
All right, we're on the way. Just sit tight. All right, just sit tight. We're on the way.
All right, please hurry.
Christopher was our only child. He was so special.
To be able to have the 911 audio was really very important. The most emotional, poignant moment for me is when he asked him, please hurry, and thank you. To be able to have that
presence of mind
under pressure like that, I thought was just remarkable. I was really proud of him. I mean, to be able to keep that cool and request, please hurry. I think that was his last words.
The sonic record of that day, the audible record of that day, is essential because the visual record of that day is limited to the exteriors. What we see with our eyes are two buildings in flames. And these calls and these radio transmissions, they show us through sound what we couldn't see with our eyes. They're part of the fabric of the day that we wouldn't know or have any understanding of without this sonic record.
Go, go. Easy, no. Go, easy.
There's a tree in front of my house that was planted the week after Melissa was born. The tree grew up, Melissa grew up, and the tree grew up to be probably the biggest tree on the street. And Melissa grew up to be such a fine, nice, beautiful young lady. Melissa would have been 39 last week. Now the tree is probably 40, 50 feet high. When I planted it, it was 5 feet high and as skinny as two fingers together. So, you know, I look out and I see that tree and I just remember the day she was born. September 11th started like any other morning. woke up, put a pot of coffee in. I was making the bed and the telephone rang. I don't usually answer the phone because having been in construction my whole life, people call up, have a tendency to want you to do a job for them for nothing or give them some advice, so I don't usually answer the phone. But this morning, I did. It was my daughter, Melissa. I knew she was in New York. I didn't know anything that had happened at that particular point in time. Melissa was a little hysterical. I told her, honey, you have to slow down so that your father can understand what the problem is. She got her composure, said to me, Dad, I'm on the 101st floor of the World Trade Center, and a bomb just went off. In my bedroom was a TV set. I turned it on, happened to be on CNN. I saw the fire, I saw the smoke. I was heartbroken. She told me the fire wasn't her major concern, but there was an awful lot of smoke. So I said to her, honey, I said, can you see an exit sign? She said, yes, Dad. And I said, well, under all the exit signs, honey, are stairwells. I said, you get to that stairwell as fast as you can and get out of the building.
But unknown to Melissa and her father, all three of the stairwells had been destroyed. Trapped just three floors above the impact zone, Melissa would have no means of escape.
She was in trouble, and she called her father for help. I was 130 miles away. There was nothing I could do but give her advice. We exchanged I love yous. And to my knowledge, I was the last person from the outside world that she spoke with.
There's no injuries, but the people are trapped. They don't know where you're waiting on the 106th floor of the World Trade Center.
All right, we're there. We're taking care of it.
Okay.
In the immediate aftermath of the attack, the emergency services were overwhelmed by thousands of calls from the North Tower.
Remain in the location you are, but something by the door to block the
smoke. Stay where you are. We have you on the 92nd floor, southwest corner.
Sure, if you can get out of the building, then get out of the building. If you can't, just remain there and somebody will get you.
How many other people are with you right now?
200?
Morning! Happy birthday!
Wow! Okay, you want to open this? It says, McCall, this was my favorite toy when I was two. I hope you like it. Natalie.
I think 9/11 comes up pretty regularly in everybody's lives. I mean, you watch television, you go to an airport, anytime you travel.
You didn't go to Zita's house?
Did you see Granny?
So much has changed since 9/11. Everybody talks about 9/11. It's in the newspapers probably every day. And all I think about when I hear that 9/11 is, I am so proud that my husband did what he could that morning.
Jim Gartenberg had accepted a better paid job at a new company 4 days earlier. Welcome news, as his wife Jill was pregnant with their second child. September the 11th was his last commute to work at the North Tower.
I went to work soon after he did, and my office is very close to our apartment, so I just walked the few blocks. When I got there, there was a message light blinking, and I listened to the machine right away.
Jill, there's a fire. I love you, Jill. I love you. I don't know if I'm going to be okay. I love you so much.
And that was, I didn't even know what that meant. I listened to the message actually several times because I wasn't really sure what he was saying. I couldn't believe what he was saying. Just a minute later, I spoke to him. Unlike the message on the machine, which sounded frantic, when I first spoke to him, he sounded very calm, very controlled. He said to me, I'm going to be okay. you know, there's a fire, but I'm going to be okay. And he said, I said, stay down low. I mean, right? What we learned, stay down low if there's a fire. And he stayed down low, and he was hiding behind a desk, and he was trying to call for help, and he had no idea what was going on.
500 miles away in Chicago, Jim's closest friend, Adam, had only just arrived at work.
I turned on CNBC, and they said, you know, we go live to the World Trade Center, and there was smoke coming out of the building. The first thing I did was call his office. He picked up the phone right away, and he had a voice that I'd never heard before, and it was, you know, just utter panic and fear and expletives. There's fire, there's smoke everywhere, there's debris, I can't get out. You got to get me out of here. He had asked what happened, and he didn't know, and I didn't know.
Jim Gartenberg was on the 86th floor of the North Tower. Although he was six floors below the point of impact, Jim and a colleague were trapped by debris as the floors collapsed above them.
His comments were then, real calm, okay, what are we supposed to do? And I told him, there's fire and it's going up, you need to get down. And he said, I can't go anywhere, the stairs are blown out below us, you know, the debris is too heavy, we can't move anything.
It was very unusual that people outside had almost a greater sense of alarm and urgency than the people inside who were in the dark. Families were seeing the billowing smoke and the flames licking up the side of the building. It was just a terrible responsibility for the people on the outside to have to say, it's worse than you think.
15 minutes after the North Tower had been hit, most people in Tower 2, the South Tower, were still at their desks and watching the tragedy unfold. Amongst them was 24-year-old trader Brad Fetchett, who left a message for his mother to tell her he was safe.
Hey, Mom, it's Brad. Just wanted to call and let you know. I'm sure that you heard that a plane crashed into World Trade Center 1. We're fine. We're in World Trade Center 2. I'm obviously alive and well over here, but obviously a pretty scary experience. I saw a guy fall out of probably the 91st story all the way down. So you're welcome to give a call here. I think we'll be here all day, but give me a call back later. Love you.
He was trying to reassure us that he was okay. But you could tell as he cleared his voice when he talked about seeing someone fall from the 91st floor that there was a lot of fear in his voice.
It's available anytime I want to play it back. It's there. I hear it, and I know it. And I'm still very fragile to listen to it. And so I'm comforted to know it's there, but I don't listen to it.
Eight floors above Brad in the South Tower was 42-year-old systems analyst Shimmy Beagleisen.
The phone rang and it was Shimmy. Ma, don't worry, I'm fine. And I said, please don't waste any time. I know all about it. Get out. And he said, listen. And he put the receiver up to the loudspeaker and I heard the announcement. Do not leave your office. This building is secure. As we hung up, my nephew called, and he was practically incoherent. He said, Shimmy, Trade Center. I said, Shimmy is okay. And as I said, okay, I never got the K out because I saw the plane hit the other building.
At 9:03, 17 minutes after the North Tower was struck, United Airlines Flight 173 flew into the South Tower. Immediately, the emergency services were flooded with calls, as 700 people were trapped above the impact zone.
Approximately two-thirds of the way up, you got visible fire showing out.
Lieutenant, Manhattan Dispatch.
Yes, hi.
Major disaster, number 2 World Trade Center, requesting everything possible.
Which Northwest Conference Room.
Tower 2, room 105.
This is at the World Trade Center. People are trapped. I have a call on the line.
The line is open.
What floor are you on?
They're not answering.
We're getting millions of calls there. All I can say is they will stay near the window, stay low for the tower by
the firefighters in the city are on their way over there.
Yes, sir.
I understand that. All right, we're trying to get the people as fast as we can.
Mom, it's Steven. My building got hit by a plane, and right now it's, I think I'm okay, I'm safe now, but it's smoky. I just want to say how much I love you, and, I will call you when I'm safe. Okay, Mom? Bye.
It's a tribute to Stephen that, at the moment of his death, it can be said that he was on good terms with every member of his family. And that's not easy. Stephen was with us for 33 years, and we have a choice. We can either say we are so mad that he's not here, or we can say we had him for 33 years. And we have a feast to return to, the feast of the memories. The family came, girl, boy, girl, so there was a little triumvirate at the top. And then 4 boys came in a very quick succession. And Stephen was the 3rd of that group of 4.
Stephen was very relaxed, smiling, laughing.
He was very laid back, very happy. You know, he really was happy a lot of the time.
Stephen was really a peacekeeper within the family because we all have very strong personalities, and at a dinner table we all want to voice our opinion, and Stephen was the best, I think, of any of us, of listening to all sides of an argument and really keeping the peace. That was the role that I thought he played in our family.
He definitely did that, and it's a challenge to fill that role now.
Following a successful career as a college basketball player, Stephen had moved to New York. At 33, he was now a trader with an investment company in the South Tower.
September 11th, it was a beautiful, beautiful day, as everyone always will remember, I know. I was very pleased to be going to a yoga class around the corner in the Village Hall. And at the end of the class, I walked home. And when I came into this house, there was a blinking light on the answering machine, and I had 6 messages. Not the usual thing. And one of the messages was from Stephen.
Mom, it's Stephen. My building got hit by a plane. And right now, it's, I think I'm okay, I'm safe now, but it's smoky. I just want to say how much I love you. And I will call you when I'm safe. Okay, Mom? Bye.
Stephen worked in the South Tower. He was on the 89th floor. He said that he was going to call me and that he was going to be all right. there were messages then from people calling to say, Anne, are your children all right? And then there was a message from my husband. And he said, promise me you will not turn on the television. And that was an easy promise to make. I just went out in the backyard and I sat in a plastic, you know, those $5 plastic chairs under a tree and with the phone in my lap, preparing myself for what I would need to face.
Okay, now you can soak in wet towels and you can put them at the doorway.
And you're at Two World Trade, right?
And you're going to hand the door.
Sorry, are you on the 88th or 88th?
Families often have a map in their minds of where their loved ones are in the world. You know, if somebody in your family is working at a place that has now become the center of all the world's attention, and there's a calamity unfolding, in your mind, you're trying to place your loved one. Where are they in relationship to this terrible series of events that's unfolding?
I feel so bad that we can't do more. You don't know. Oh, boy. Mm. It's an awful thing. It's an awful, awful, awful thing to call somebody and tell them you're going to die. That's an awful thing.
Just seconds before the South Tower was hit, Shimmy Biegeleisen's mother had urged him to leave. Now he was trapped on the 97th floor. By 9:15, the family apartment in Brooklyn had filled with Shimmy's loved ones. The phone passed between them, as each offered him consolation and advice.
We had Shimmy on the phone. We were trying to find different ways how to calm him down and relax him, possibly other different ways of maybe getting out, him trying different exits. At one point when I was talking to him, he shared a few private things with me. He asked me to look after his wife and children. And all this time, I was able to hear in his voice that the situation was becoming a lot worse.
There was now fire and dense smoke above the impact zone. Those trapped there began to panic. Shimmy's close friend, David, called to try and calm him.
Shimmy? Yeah. Just hang in there. Just breathe slowly through the towel. You're breathing through the towel?
I'm fine.
Everything's fine. Everybody's fine. Everybody's very calm. Everything's going to be fine. You have to stay calm. Everybody here is calm, I promise you. You girls don't even know because they're in school. Your parents are here. They're very calm. Keep your head straight. Okay, do you see smoke by the window? The fire department wants to know. You can't see?
Do we see smoke by the window? The fire department wants to know. No smoke by the window.
No smoke by the window. Listen carefully. As a last resort, break the window as small as possible just to get a little air in. Okay, but you foul?
Yeah.
Okay, how so?
They said the last resort, we should open the window just a little bit to get some air in.
Can you open the window or you have to break it? Yeah.
Huh? You have to break it.
Yeah. Okay, Shimmy.
Yeah.
Break the window. As little as possible. Just get a little air. Just get a little air. Okay. If you're running out of air.
We should do that.
Okay.
Okay?
I'm very grateful that he was able to spend his last moment speaking to the people who were closest to him. At the end of your life, I would imagine you want some sort of comfort, and I hope, and it seems from what everyone has told me, that he was given that. That's all I could hope for.
In the North Tower, the first to be hit, Jim Gartenberg had been trapped by falling debris for more than half an hour. Having spoken to his wife, Jill, and best friend Adam, Jim now wanted his predicament to be known to the watching world. He managed to make contact with a reporter at the New York Times, Jim Dwyer.
I spoke with him several times that morning. And I was trying to understand what his predicament was, why he couldn't get to the stairs or why he couldn't get to an exit. And he said that, you know, the walls were cracking and folding over, and he couldn't get to where he needed to be. Mr. Gartenberg seemed to be very directed, very focused. I mean, he was, you know, there's a sense of great urgency in his voice, but I didn't feel like he was panicking. He wanted people to know where he was and that he couldn't leave the building.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you, Nicole.
Yay!
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 Are you taking a picture?
Jim has always been a leader. And I think that showed through on that day.
Nicole, is Daddy so funny?
When I first met Jim, he was the president of the Michigan Alumni Club in New York. I saw the way that he was running this meeting and the way he was interacting with people and his leadership skills. There was all these qualities about him that all of a sudden I said, wow, this is a really special guy.
After speaking to the New York Times, Jim's next call was to a local TV news program. At 9:32, 45 minutes after the North Tower was hit, Jim went live on air.
Jim Gartenberg joins us. He was on the 86th floor of, I'm not sure which tower, was it the east, north or south, Jim?
It's World Trade Center 1, and it's not was. I am here, and I'm stuck right now.
Now, are you above, Jim, or below?
I have no idea. I have no idea where the plane hit. It's my understanding that it's a plane.
Jim, there are two planes. One went into one tower, one went into the other tower. What do you see around you? I mean, are you in smoke? Are you in fire? I mean,
the first thing that I want to make clear is that I'm stuck on the 86th floor. A fire door has trapped us. Debris has fallen around us, and part of the core of the building is blown out.
How many people are with you, Jim?
I'm with one other person, and I'm told that people are aware of this. I'm on the 86th floor on the east side of the building facing the East River.
And what time
did
you get...
If I'm on the air, I want to tell anybody that has a family member that may be in the building that the situation is under control for the moment, and the danger has not increased. So please, all family members, take it easy.
I got a phone call from a friend of mine on my cell phone saying, Jill, Jim's going to be okay. He was just on national television and he said he's going to be okay. She told me what he said and how confident he was about it.
They broadcast his voice. I still have tapes of that and listen to it, and it's eerie. The voice that I hear on that is not his, and it's just so odd as far as the voice is concerned. But his message was unbelievably calm and brave and stoic. Having seen that was just a tremendous tribute.
I think for a lot of people to be in crisis mode, they would just sit there and scream. And Jim would kind of regroup with himself, it seems like, and said, okay, this is the situation. How do I best deal with this? And he reached out to as many people as he could, trying to figure out what resources he had to be helpful in this situation. I mean, he had the sense of mind to do that.
And the danger has not increased, so please, all family members, take it easy.
I think that was wonderful, but I knew in my heart he was not going to be okay.